You know, if you and I are going to understand what the Bible says, I mean, really understand its depths, we're going to have to learn about the manners and the customs that were current in Bible times. The Bible isn't a Western book. You know, it wasn't written at a time when there were automobiles and electricity and the modern conveniences we have today. The Bible was an Eastern book, and then, of course, there's parts of the New Testament that have Greek customs or Roman customs. And even within the Bible, remember the Bible is written over a period of 4,000 years of the Old Testament. Even within the biblical time, the customs often changed from one time to another in the Bible. But if you and I are going to understand what the Bible says, then we have to understand the customs of the time. Learning biblical customs is pretty important. I mean, first of all, it keeps us from misunderstanding a verse. And the truth of what the Bible is communicating is so important. It doesn't help. It's not helpful to read a verse in the Bible and have a completely misunderstanding of what it says. Just be completely wrong in our interpretation. That's not helpful. That's not what we want to do. That's not how God is going to teach us from His Word. And if we understand the manners and customs, we have a much better chance of really understanding what God is saying. And another reason for understanding the manners and customs of the Bible is it really helps us connect with how the people lived and really enjoy the Bible. You know, God made us as people to really want to know about people. That's why, you know, People Magazine is so successful and all of the magazines that talk about people's lives, and why gossip is so common, even though the Bible says not to do it, because people love to know about people and talk about people. And if we're going to know about people and talk about people, then it's helpful if we know how they lived. And that's what biblical manners and customs do. And the customs of the Bible times, particularly the Eastern customs as opposed to the Roman customs, are so different in many ways than what you and I experience in Western culture. For example, let's take hats and shoes. In Western culture, a man walks into a church, he takes off his hat, he leaves his shoes on. In the East, in the biblical culture, you walk into a holy place, you leave your hat on. Of course, they didn't have hats. They had wraps and turbans and that kind of thing. But you left your headgear on and you took off your shoes. Exactly the opposite of what we do. In the West, a man gives up his seat for a woman. In the biblical culture, a woman gave up her seat for a man. In the West, men allow the women to be served first at dinner, for example, or a meal. In the East, the men were always served first, and the women and children served later. In generally speaking, in the West, men generally speaking, it's, of course, here I am with a big beard, but, you know, in my father's generation, certainly, most men shaved their beard. But in the East, having a full beard was something to be very proud of, and it was very important to them. When it came, for example, to dealing with animals, in the West, we drive our cattle and we drive our sheep from behind, you know, using whips and shouts and whatever, you know, they crack the whip and make the noise and the animals get going, you know. But in the East, the shepherd talks to the sheep, sings to the sheep, and leads them, and the sheep follow. So in the West, we drive. In the East, they lead. Even things like in carpentry. In the West, you know, if you've ever seen a carpenter with a saw, the cutting stroke is always out. In the East, the cutting stroke is in. You pull in to do the carpenter. Let's talk about love and marriage. You know, in the West, we date, we court, we fall in love, and then we marry. Many, many times in the East, the couple has never met. The parents arrange the marriage, and it's taught and believed that love comes after the marriage. You fall in love after you're married. In the West, a girl generally takes the name of her husband. In the East, She generally keeps her own name and is often known by the name of her father. In the West, the man and his wife walk arm in arm. In the East, the wife follows behind the man walking. That's, by the way, why Lot could not notice that his wife had turned into a pillar of salt. He's walking off and his wife is back there and he just expects she's going to be following. He didn't know that she'd turn around and had been killed. In the West, people carefully landscape their yards. You know, you can look and you say, oh, that person really loves his house. This person is very well to do. Look at how nicely his house, his yard is landscaped. In the East, they don't want anyone to know what their state of wealth is. So the outside of the houses are very plain and completely undecorated. But then inside there's a courtyard and all the opulence is on the inside so that nobody knows from the outside what the house is like. Western people, as you know, you start on the left-hand side of the page and you write to the right-hand side. Eastern people start on the right-hand side and write to the left-hand side. We write a letter and then sign it at the bottom. In the East, they sign it at the top. So there's a lot of these customs that we need to know about. For example, the Judges chapter 14, verse 5 talks about Samson. And he went down with his father and mother to Timnah. They came to the vineyards of Timnah, and behold, a young lion came toward him roaring. Now, I've been to Israel many times. I've never seen a lion. Lions don't exist there anymore. But it was a custom of Bible times that lions lived in Palestine. The true African lion lived in Palestine, lived in Israel. Not anymore. They were made extinct when the Roman gladiator games came along and the Romans rounded them all up and used them in the games. Let's talk about directions. When you and I give directions, we orient to the north. When the Easterner gives directions, he orients to the east, to the sunrise. So for example, Genesis 14:15 in the King James Version says, "And he," that's Abraham, "divided himself against them," these are his enemies, "he and his servants by night and smote them, and pursued them unto Hobah, which is on the left hand of Damascus." Now, if you and I are reading it, it's on the left hand of Damascus. Well, the left hand depends on which way you're facing, and if you and I were a map orienting, we'd say, oh, well, it must be to the west. But they look to the east, and so the left hand of Damascus is the north. How about their tents? Here's the Song of Solomon. The Shulamite woman is describing herself. She says, "I am very dark, but lovely, O daughters of Jerusalem, like the tents of Kedar." How do we know what the tents of Kedar are like? Maybe they're striped or something. And the answer is all the tents in the biblical world back then were made of goat hair. In the biblical world, goats were black. And so she's describing the dark black color of the tents of Kedar. Then there's just so many customs that we need to know. Now let me tell you, here's one that's interesting. Talk about a change in the way we think. Luke 13:32. Herod is trying to kill Jesus, seek Jesus to kill him. And so he was told, you need to run away. Herod's seeking to kill you. Jesus said to them, "Go tell that fox, behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I finish my course." Now, he said, "Go tell that fox." So Jesus Christ called Herod a fox. Today, in 2010, if you look at somebody, particularly a girl, and you say, "Wow, she's a fox," then you're saying she's cute, she's pretty. In my generation, like when I was being raised in grade school, 50 years ago, if somebody said, "That guy's a fox," it meant he was sly, cunning, that you couldn't trust him. But that neither of those meanings were the meaning in the biblical world. In the biblical world, a fox was a pest. It was just an animal that kind of came in the night and maybe ate a chicken or something like that. It was just a pest. And so here's Christ. He isn't threatened by Herod. He just says, "Go tell that pest." So I trust that you will want to learn some of the biblical customs of and things that we have. We have a book, Manners and Customs in the Bible, and that will help you, and there are many other books that will help you understand the manners and the customs of the Bible so that we can better understand it and more fully enjoy it. God bless you.